ओके, सो लेट अस स्टार्ट द न्यू टॉपिक दैट इज एंजाइम्स. सो यू वुड हैव गॉट अ ब्रीफ आइडिया अबाउट द एंजाइम, व्हाट एंजाइम्स आर पर्टिकुलरली. यू वुड हैव स्टडीड इन योर लोअर क्लासेस. सो एंजाइम्स आर ऑल्सो कॉल्ड एज बायोकैटलिस्ट. एंजाइम्स आर ऑल्सो कॉल्ड एज बायोकैटलिस्ट, राइट? नाउ व्हाट डज इट मीन, व्हाट डज इट मीन बायोकैटलिस्ट? कैटलिस्ट व्हाट डज इट मीन? सो कैटलिस्ट इज एनी सब्सटेंस विच टेक्स पार्ट इन रिएक्शन, विच इंक्रीजेज द रेट ऑफ रिएक्शन विदाउट टेकिंग पार्ट इन इट. So which increases the rate of reaction without taking part in that reaction or without change going undergoing any change in itself. Okay. So what is catalyst? Catalyst is any substance which increases the rate of reaction without taking part in that reaction. Okay. And in the case of biology, most of the biochemical reactions, the metabolic reactions which are taking place inside the body are basically catalyzed by some specific substances. And these substances are called as enzymes. And hence, they are also called as biocatalysts. So what are enzymes? Enzymes are the some molecules which increases the rate of reaction. Okay. Now, it was discovered by Buckner and the term enzyme was given by Kone. Right. Now, most of the time, the enzymes is found to be the protein in nature. It's mainly found in protein in nature. But there are some exceptions. Sometimes the RNA may also function as an enzyme, that is called as ribozyme. You may note it down. So most of the time, the enzymes are protein in nature. But sometimes the RNA may also be carrying out the function of enzyme. So there might be a statement that most of enzymes are proteins. We can say But most of proteins are enzymes, that's not true, right? So you have to be very much clear what you want to write. Okay, so most of the enzymes are basically protein nature, except few where the instead of protein, the RNA will be functioning as an enzyme. Those are called as ribozyme. Okay, so let us start with enzymes. What are general properties of enzymes? So enzymes are comparatively large sized molecule. When we see about different other molecules like proteins, other nucleic acids and all that, carbohydrates. So comparatively, it is a comparatively large sized molecule. It's a protein which is made up of, maybe it's a single unit, but tertiary structure protein, or maybe having quaternary structure as well. Okay. And it's a large size molecules, colloid in nature. You know, you would be familiar with the colloid. It's a type of solution. It's a type of solution where the size of the solid particle is intermediate, right? So here the size of property, size of the enzyme is not so small, not so big as well. So it is functioning as a colloid in nature and having a high molecular weight. Its highest molecular weight is of enzyme pyruvate dehydrogenase complex. PDH complex is an enzyme which is used during the linking reaction of the respiration. So you will be studying this respiration where it is found in the perimitochondrial space, where it will be basically connecting the Krebs cycle with the glycolysis. Okay, so it's called as a linking reaction, and this is one of the largest enzyme is known, or we can say highest, having the enzyme having the highest molecular weight. Okay, that's a 46 lakh, it means 4.6 million is that its molecular weight, right? Dalton. The enzyme can accelerate the reaction rate by about 10 million times. This is where you can get an idea of why the enzyme is so important. Let me give an example of a reaction carried out by carbonic anhydrase. You may note it down. The carbonic anhydrase is an enzyme which carry out the reaction between CO2 plus H2O, and it form H2CO3. It is found in blood. Okay. So now this reaction, when it is without enzyme, so 200 molecules of H2CO3 will be formed. 200 molecules of H2CO3 will be formed in around 1 hour. Right? So without enzyme, the same molecule will be formed. 200 molecules will form in 1 hour. But when we are taking enzyme, so the same reaction can occur with in the same reaction will be occurring. 6,000 molecules in the same reaction, 6,000 molecules will be formed in 1 second. So without enzyme, it is taking 1 hour to form 200 molecules. While in the case of enzyme, in presence of enzyme, the same reaction is taking place that fast, that key, it will be forming 6,000 molecules in 1 second. So this is how the enzyme brings out the speed. Okay, so it increases the rate of reaction by many times. So around 10 million times in the case of this enzyme particularly, right? Carbonic anhydrase is the fastest enzyme known. Okay, so this is how the enzyme will be taking part in the reaction. Now, enzymes are protein, let us see some characteristic of the enzymes. So enzymes are proteinaceous in nature. As I already told you, most of the enzymes are proteinaceous in nature, not all of them. Some of them are also made up of RNA, and hence we can say they are ribozymes. Okay. Next, most of enzymes are arranged in tertiary structure of protein or globular. So I have told you that this, most of the enzymes are tertiary, having tertiary structure. We are already done with primary, secondary, tertiary structure. You know what is it? Okay, so they will be tertiary structure and will be proteinaceous and will be showing the globular protein mostly. It provides this structure, tertiary structure or globular structure, provides the stability and water soluble nature to the enzymes. Because of this globular structure, it will be more stable and would be able to solubilize in water, and this is something which adds on their functionality. And it is synthesized on the ribosomes because it's a type of protein, and protein are mostly or it's always synthesized in the ribosome, on the ribosomes only. So it will also require the ribosomes for its synthesis. Okay. Specificity: enzymes are very specific for the pH, temperature and the substrate. So the enzymes cannot function with less pH or more pH. Like suppose the enzymes which is functioning in the stomach, which require around 2 pH, okay, 2 to 2.5 pH pepsin. So the same reaction, same enzyme, if you basically carry out the reaction inside or outside the body or somewhere where the pH is basically higher, let us say 5 pH or 4 pH, still that enzyme will not be functioning properly. So it will be having of the proper range of functioning, that is 2.5 to 2 pH. Okay, that will be the functioning range of the pepsin. Similarly, the enzyme which is present alkaline will be require a bit of alkaline nature, right? It will be requiring around 8 to 8.5 pH. Okay, the enzyme which is present in the intestine, okay, that is trypsin, suppose. The same trypsin, if we drop it into a stomach where the pH is 2.5, so it won't be able to function. So every enzyme will be having their own specific pH at which they can work. Every enzyme will have their own pH at which they can work. Similarly, every enzyme will be having own temperature at that we work. Mostly the enzymes will be having a range of temperature that may be from 20 degree to 40 degree is the best temperature range we can basically say. So below the temperature, below the proper temperature, the enzyme becomes temporarily inactive. The enzymes become temporarily inactive. Okay, so it is basically important. So at the low temperature also, the enzyme will be inactive. And at the higher temperature also, the enzymes will be basically getting denatured. At a higher temperature, the enzyme will get denatured. You've already seen what the denature is. Denature is when the protein loses its structure, when protein loses its structure by breaking up the bonds of present between them. So it is called denaturation, right? So at a higher temperature, the enzyme will get denatured, while at low temperature, it will be becoming transitionally inactive, temporarily inactive. Okay, so this is how the temperature also has to be at a proper range, for its proper functioning. Okay, next is the substrate. Now, substrate is so important. Every enzyme will be specific to its substrate. It will not be binding to any other substances apart. What are substrate? First of all, let us discuss. Substrate is any substance. Substrate is any substance on which the enzyme will be acting. Substrate is any substance on which the enzyme is acting. Suppose my substrate is glucose. Or suppose my maltose is divided. Maltose is broken down into glucose plus glucose with the help of enzyme called as amylase. With the help of enzyme called as amylase. Or we can say maltase. With the help of enzyme called as maltase. So maltase is an enzyme, and the maltose is the substrate for this enzyme. Okay. And the glucose which is formed is a product. So every enzyme has got specific substrate. Suppose the maltase is an enzyme which is responsible for breaking down the maltose. If sucrose is present, the maltose will not be able to break down the sucrose. Okay, maltose will not be able to break down the sucrose because it is not its specificity. So every enzyme will be specific for its substrate, right? Second, where the substrate binds, the substrate binds to the active site. Active site is something basically on an enzyme. It is believed to have a particular region where the substrate will be binding. Suppose this is my enzyme. So this is the part where the substrate will be binding. This is the part where the substrate will bind. Okay. So this is called as active site, where the binding of substrate take place and the enzyme action is carried on. Okay. So what is substrate binding site? It is the active site where the substrate binds and substrate will be broken down or substrate will be converted into other product. Okay. So substrate binds at active site of an enzyme which is made of specific sequence of amino acids and recognize its substrate. So it will not be able to, no other substrate will be binding the active site. And most of the cases, in some cases it may bind, but most of the cases will not be able to bind because the active site of the enzyme will be able to recognize its substrate. Now enzyme increases the rate of reaction by decreasing activation energy. Now we will see how this actually the enzyme will be carrying out this reaction so fast. Okay, so normally what is happening, normal cases, normally whenever the enzyme is, the reaction is taking place, so this is, any reaction needs a particular amount of energy to be carried on, any reaction needs a particular amount of energy to be getting completed. So suppose an energy A and B are the reactant which require to be converted into C and D. So this A and B has to come together. This A and B has to come together at a time. And to bring them together, it will require energy. It will require energy from the surrounding. Okay. And this energy is basically shown here by this peak. So what will happen? This peak is called as activation energy. This peak is called my activation energy. What is activation energy? It is the minimum energy required. It is the minimum energy required to carry out the reaction. It is the minimum energy required to carry out the reaction. So here we can say, what is activation energy? The minimum amount of energy more than the free energy of reactants required to reach the transition state of chemical reaction or to undergo the chemical reaction. In simple words, we can say, what is activation energy? It's the minimum energy required to carry out the reaction. So this is the reactant state, this is the transition state where it can go in both the direction, over here as well, over here as well, right? So the energy which is required to bring this transition state into the reactant to completion of reaction is called as activation energy. So what is activation energy? Minimum energy required, minimum amount of energy required to bring out the chemical reaction. So what does the enzyme will do? Enzyme will lower down this enzyme. The enzyme will lower down this activation energy. This enzyme will lower down its activation energy. So here in the presence of enzyme, this graph, this peak has basically decreased. This peak has got decreased. And in the absence of enzyme, the graph, the peak was at a higher range, almost double. And in the presence of enzyme, the graph has got reduced to half almost. Okay. How does it happen? It is because of lowering down of activation energy with the help of enzyme. So how exactly this enzyme is lowering down this activation energy? Many people are still searching out, don't have a proper explanation, and even will not be having right now. Okay. So, but there are a lot of hypotheses which are working on, and we'll see what all hypotheses are there. Next characteristic is the turnover number. So what is turnover number? It's the number of reactant molecules converted into product by one molecule of enzyme in unit time. So suppose there is an enzyme which is converting 100 molecules, which is converting 100 reactant molecules into 100 products, during 1 minute. So the turnover number of 1 second, suppose the turnover will be basically 100, right? So highest turnover is the carbonic anhydrase, that is 360 lakh per minute. So in carbonic anhydrase can convert 360 lakh number of substrate into product within a minute by a single enzyme molecule. Keep it in mind, by a single enzyme molecule, not by a group of enzyme molecule. So if you suppose take 100 molecules, so 100 into 360 you can do in 1 minute, right? So this is the level of the speed which it can achieve with the help of enzyme. Okay, so what is turnover number? The number of reactants molecules converted into product by one molecule of enzyme in unit time. That unit time mostly can be taken as minute or second. Highest turnover number is of carbonic anhydrase, that is 360 lakh per minute. Okay, now whenever the reaction is basically taking place, the enzyme carry out the here we have seen the two graphs. Here we have got a two scales. The one is the rate of reaction on the y scale and substrate concentration on the x scale, right? So when we basically increases the concentration, the rate of reaction will also increase. When we increase the concentration, here we are increasing the concentration, so exponentially the rate of reaction is also increased. Why? Because the enzymes will be having active site, and until unless the high amount of concentration is not provided, what will happen? There are a lot of active sites will be remaining free on the enzyme molecule. So when the concentration of substrate is increased, they will be occupied, and after a particular period of time, all the active sites of the enzyme will be occupied by the substrate, and hence no rate of reaction will be increased further. And that particular point is called as Vmax. That particular point is called as velocity maximum. It means that maximum velocity of the reaction has achieved. Maximum velocity of the reaction or rate of reaction is achieved. That is called as Vmax, which is basically now getting linear. Okay, so this is what is Vmax. Vmax is that concentration of the substrate, where the maximum velocity is attained, or the reaction or rate of reaction of enzyme is highest. Okay, this is called as Vmax. Okay, now the rate of reaction is that concentration at which the rate of reaction is half of the maximum, this concentration of reaction where the rate of concentration is half of maximum is called as Km, is called as Km. So that concentration at which the rate of reaction is half is called as half Vmax, or we can say Km. What is Km? Km is the part, that substrate concentration where the rate of reaction of enzyme is the half. Okay, so this is what basically right now we understood. Now let us see how you have to utilize it. Okay, now with the increasing concentration of substrate, the enzymatic velocity also increases. As I told you, the concentration of substrate at which the velocity of enzymatic action reaches half of its maximum value is called as Km value or Michaelis constant. This Km value, or we can say Km constant, or we can say Michaelis constant. Higher is the affinity of an enzyme for a substrate, the lower its Km value. So more the energy, more the affinity is there for the enzyme, the substrate, the Km value will be lower. Okay, so you can see here the Km value is inversely proportional to the affinity. The Km value is inversely proportional to its affinity, right? So the higher the Km value, the lower the affinity. Lower the Km value, higher the affinity. This is something you have to keep in mind. Now let us see the structure of enzyme. Okay, so the enzymes can be simple or it can be conjugated. Let us see. So the enzymes can be simple enzymes or it can be conjugated. So here you can see simple enzymes. It's made up of only proteins. There is no other substance along with that proteins. So proteins are only the one which will be basically functioning as an enzyme. It will not be requiring any type of other associated substances. While in the case of conjugated enzymes, it is also called a holoenzyme. The conjugated enzymes are also called as holoenzyme, or we can say whole enzyme, where it's functional enzyme, right? It is made up of protein plus a non-protein part. So the conjugating enzymes are enzymes consisting two or more than two parts, where the one part is basically the enzymatic part, which is protein part, and other part will be the non-protein part. The one part will be protein part and other part will be non-protein part. The protein part is called as apoenzyme. Make sure the protein part is called as apoenzyme. Okay, and the conjugated enzyme which is functional in nature, is called as holoenzyme. So apoenzyme is the protein part of that conjugated enzyme, and the non-protein part can be of three types. You have to keep in mind, non-protein part can be of three types, that is coenzyme, cofactor, or prosthetic group. Coenzyme, cofactor, or prosthetic group. So first of all, let us see the what is prosthetic group is. The prosthetic group is the tightly attached organic, may organic, cannot be easily separated. So it may be organic or inorganic substances which is tightly attached, which is cannot be separated from the protein part of the enzyme. That is called as prosthetic group, right? Apart from this, there can be coenzyme. Coenzyme is also associated with the apoenzyme, but will be loosely attached, which can be removed. Example, and it will be organic part of enzyme. What is it? It is organic part of enzyme, right? So coenzyme is example organic part of enzyme which can be removed from the enzyme and which is not tightly attached. Okay, example NADP, NAD, FMN, FAD, AMP, vitamins and all that, right? These are different type of coenzymes. These all are organic substances. Prosthetic group can be organic, can be inorganic, but it is has to be tightly bound. Coenzyme is organic always and not tightly bound. It is reversibly bound. Okay, while the cofactor is loosely bound inorganic substances. The cofactor is loosely bound inorganic substances, mostly the metallic ions like Fe, Mg, Zn, which are used by the enzyme for different purposes, mainly for the oxidation reduction purposes, right? So we have seen what is simple enzyme, only protein. Conjugated enzymes, protein and non-protein part, it may be having both things. Coenzymes are the non-protein organic groups which are loosely attached to the apoenzymes. And prosthetic groups, when non-protein part is tightly or firmly attached to the apoenzyme, it is called as prosthetic group, right? Metal activators or cofactors, or we can say metal effector, loosely attached inorganic cofactor, example manganese, ferrous, cobalt, zinc, calcium, magnesium, etc. Now the infrastructure, we can see active site. What is active site? I have already told you, it's a part of the polypeptide chain made up of specific sequences of amino acids at which the specific substrate is to bind it. It means it's a site where the substrate will bind. In simple form, we can say it's a site where the substrate will. In the simple substance, we can say it's a site where the substrate will bind. That's called an active site. Okay. And this is highly specific for that particular substrate. Why? Because the sequence of amino acids which is present over here will be specialized for that particular substrate. It will be specialized for the particular substrate, right? Allostric site. Apart from this active site, there might be sometime another site as well. This is my active site, suppose. This is my active site. And apart from the active site, there might be another site where the other substance apart from the substrate may bind. So it's an additional site at which chemical other than substrate, that is called as allosteric modulator. Allosteric modulator bind. So suppose this is my active site, this is the active site, but suppose X is my substrate. So X has to be bind over here. But apart from X, something, suppose Y substance is getting bound over here, which is site apart from this active site, is called as allosteric site, which may lead to the change in the shape of this enzyme as well, which may lead to the change in the shape of enzyme this well. Okay, so that was the allosteric site and active site. Let us see some terminology about the enzymes. So first of all, endoenzymes, these are the enzymes which are functioning inside the cell. These are the enzymes which are functioning inside the cell. Most of metabolic enzymes like the phosphorylase, like the hexokinase, these are the enzymes which are functioning inside the cells, right? They are called as endoenzymes. Exoenzymes, as you can understand, it has the, these are the enzymes which are functioning outside the cell. These are the enzymes which are functioning outside the cell. Example, the fermentation enzyme required for fermentation, all the digestive enzymes like lipase, trypsin, chemotrypsin, all are basically functioning outside the cell. That's called as exoenzymes. And the third one is proenzyme or zymogen. These are the form of inactive enzyme. These are the form of inactive enzyme which get activated on having substrate. So they will be getting activated. Example, trypsinogen. Example, trypsinogen, pepsinogen. These are the inactive enzymes which will be activated and then they will be getting their function. Isoenzymes are enzymes which are of different, same type of enzyme but having different forms and originating or working, functioning in different parts. Like the amylase have different forms, amylase 1, amylase 2, right? So similarly, lactate dehydrogenase has got different forms. So same enzyme will be having it present in different forms called as isoenzyme. Inducible enzymes are the enzymes which will be formed. Inducible enzymes are the enzymes which will produce or synthesize only when the substrate is available. So these are the enzymes which will produce only when the substrate is available, otherwise they are not going to produce. Example, nitrogenase. So when the nitrogen is present, the nitrogen will be getting activated and they will be formed, they will be produced. So they are controlled by genetic regulation. So their inducible enzymes are the enzymes which will produce only during the requirement when the substrates are present. Extremozymes are those enzymes which can also function during the extreme conditions like the very high temperature, very low pH, very high pH. Okay, so these are the conditions which are so extreme where the normally enzymes will be not functioning, but these enzymes will be functioning well. Example, TAC polymerase, Thermus aquaticus, TAQ. TAC polymerase, Thermus aquaticus polymerase. This is an enzyme which is responsible for basically carrying out the polymerization reaction. It is used for biotechnology. So it is a type of extremozyme. Last one is the biodetergents. It's a type of artificially synthesized enzyme which can be used for the laundry purposes, where the it is used as a detergent to emulsify the substances or to even to really remove out the dirt substances from in the form of which are present in the form of starch or in the form of lipids, oils and all that. Okay, so that was about the different terminology for the enzymes. These are the different metal ions present in the metal enzymes. Metal enzymes are the enzymes where the metal ions are present and having got some specific roles within them. There's a whole list, you can also see that and you can read and you can learn it, you can understand it. Okay, these are the different, like ferrous is present in ferrous 2 plus and ferrous 3 plus form, cytochrome oxidase, catalase, acetonase, peroxidase, copper is present in copper oxidase, trypsinose, tyrosinase, okay, ascorbic acid, oxidase, peptidase are having the cobalt. Zn is present is alcohol dehydrogenase, carbonic anhydrinase, LDH, carboxypeptidase. So these are different metals that are present different enzymes. They will be having some specific roles in these enzymes as well. Okay, so that was about the structure of enzymes. Now let us start with the classification of enzyme. Classification of enzymes. So when we say classification of enzymes, mainly the all the enzymes are divided into six different classes. Different six classes, and on the basis of the classes only, the enzymes can also be given name. The nomenclature of enzyme can also be done with the help of these classes. Right now we are not going to deal with this because it's not of the part. Okay, syllabus. It's not a part of our syllabus, but still we can have a brief idea about this. So classification, the enzymes can be classified into different six classes according to which the enzymes can also be named. The first class is oxidoreductase, cytochrome oxidase example. So these are the oxidase reductase enzymes. The first class is oxidoreductase enzyme which will be carrying out either oxidation or reduction. So how will it will carry out? It will be carrying out oxidation reduction by either giving out the electron, by taking electron, by giving out hydrogen or taking hydrogen. So different forms of oxidation reduction can be carried out with the help of oxidoreductase enzymes. So these all enzymes are coming under the class 1. Second class is the transferase. Transferase is an enzyme which will be transferring the substrate from one place to another. That is glutamate pyruvate transaminase, where the amino group is transported from glutamate to pyruvate. Okay, so here the transferase is an enzyme where like hexokinase, or we can say So phosphokinase, where the phosphate group is transferred from one place to another, one substrate to another, right? So this is called as transferase enzyme. Third one, hydrolysis. Hydrolysis are enzymes which are basically breaking down the substrate molecule into two or more than two with the help of water. This is something which is important, with the help of water. So hydrolysis enzymes, so hydro, it basically signifies the presence of water. Lysis means to break it down. So it's an enzyme which will be breaking down the complex substance into simpler form with the help of water. Most of digestive enzymes will be coming under this. Example, lipases, right? So it will be breaking down in the presence of water. Other one is lysis. So lysis is also the type of enzymes which will be breaking down the complex into simpler substance, but here the water is not involved. Water molecule is not involved. It will be not involving water molecule. It may remove out the carbon substance, carbon particle from it in the form of carbon dioxide. Example, histidine decarboxylase. And the other one is isomerase. Here the isomers are the substances having the same type of empirical formula and different structure, suppose. So these are the enzymes which will be converting one isomerase into another isomerase. Example, phosphohexoisomerase, right? So it will be containing glucose 6 phosphate to fructose 6 phosphate, glucose 6 phosphate to fructose 6 phosphate. So both will be having the 6 carbon, but both will be of different type. One fructose, glucose 6 phosphate was having the aldose sugar, it was having the aldehyde group, while the fructose has got the ketone sugar, right? That is a ketone group, right? So both are still isomers, okay? And last one is the ligases. These are the enzymes which will be responsible for joining the two segments, joining the things. Example, DNA ligase. Okay, so there are 6 different classes of enzymes, and all of the enzymes can be classified into these classes and can be named accordingly. Okay, so next is the factors affecting the enzyme, different factors which are affecting the enzyme. So we have already seen how the temperature and the pH will be required for enzyme activity. They are so specific for that. So again, let us see in a brief. So temperature and pH, so once the pH temperature increases, along with the increasing the temperature, the enzyme activity will also increase. But at a particular optimum point, the enzyme will function best, and after that it will lower down its activity by increasing temperature or pH. You can see this graph shows that with the increasing the enzyme pH, the pH of the solution, the enzyme activity will also increase. The enzyme activity also increasing, but up to a particular point, what will happen? It will reach at this maximum rate of reaction, after which if the pH is increasing, the rate of reaction will start decreasing. It means this is the point where the enzyme is functioning efficiently. This point is called as optimum pH. Similarly, in the case of temperature, when the temperature is increasing, the rate of reaction is also increasing. But up to an optimum temperature, the rate of reaction will increase, and later on it will again start decreasing. Why it is starting decreasing? Because increasing temperature, the DNA, the protein will start getting denatured, okay? And at the lower temperature, the enzyme will be present in the inactive form, right? So when we increase the temperature, it will start increasing the rate of reaction, but up to a certain level. So we have to understand that. And the third one is the enzyme activity depending on the substrate concentration. So when we are increasing the concentration of substrate, it will increase up to a certain level, and after attaining a particular level, all the active sites on the enzymes will be getting occupied, and after that the no more substrate will be basically converted into enzyme. And this is the condition where it is called as it has achieved the Vmax, that is the maximum velocity of the rate of reaction, or we can say maximum velocity of the enzyme activity. And half of this concentration is called as Vmax2, the concentration at which the rate of reaction is half of the Vmax is called as Km, is called as Michelis constant or Km value. Okay, so that is the constant Km value. I hope things are clear. Okay, next is heat. I have then told you that is the temperature, activity of temperature on the enzyme. Okay, now optimum pH already done. So we have seen the optimum pH, enzyme shows highest activity at a specific pH. This is called the optimum pH. Activity declines both above and below the optimum pH. Most intracellular enzymes function best around neutral pH. Okay, so this neutral, the intracellular enzymes which are present inside this cell require the neutral pH. Okay, they will not be functioning at the low or high pH. Okay, concentration of substrate. Now, as I told you that up to extent when the substrate is increased, amount of substrate is increased, so concentration of substrate increase, the activity of enzyme will also increase, but up to a stage they will then acquire a linear growth where no activity can be increased because all the active sites of the enzyme are already occupied by the substrate, hence it will not increase anymore. And then is the activation energy, as I already told, what is how it's functioning. The activation energy required for the conversion of substrate to product. But what does the enzyme will be doing? Enzyme will be decreasing this rate of reaction. Enzyme will be decreasing the rate of reaction. It will be decreasing the activation energy. Okay, and it will be converting the reactant into products. Okay, that is about the decreasing the activation energy. Now, mode of enzyme of action. How this enzyme will be acting. Okay, so first of all, there are different hypotheses given by different people, and most accepted hypotheses are two hypotheses, that is lock and key hypothesis and induced fit model. Okay, so let us start with the lock and key hypothesis, which was given by Emil Fischer in 1894. So according to this hypothesis, the enzymes and molecules have got a specific geometrical shape. Like the enzymes will be having a specific shape, which will be basically recognized by a specific substrate only. It will be able to recognize a specific substrate only. So this substrate will be getting along with this enzyme and will get fixed in a manner that it will form an enzyme substrate complex. And this enzyme substrate complex will now form a product. Okay, so this is called an enzyme plus substrate will form an enzyme substrate complex, which will then release to form the enzyme and plus product will be formed. Okay, similar to the key, like every lock will have a specific key. No other key will be able to get inside this lock. And when this lock is getting inside this key is getting inside the lock, they will form a complex, and then only this lock will get opened up, right? Similarly, the enzyme is functioning as a key, and this is functioning as a lock where this is coming, and it will be getting converted to product only when this enzyme will be getting formed as a complex. Okay, so these are basically specific in nature. Both the enzymes and substrate are highly specific to each other. This is something which is so important. Okay, so lock and key hypothesis says that enzyme plus substrate gives enzyme substrate complex. Later on, this enzyme substrate complex will be converted into enzyme plus and enzyme products. Okay, enzyme and products. Okay, so product will be formed. Okay, that was about the enzyme lock and key model. Okay, the next is the induced hypothesis model. So induced fit hypothesis says that the enzymes are not having the specific shape, but instead of that they will be having the flexibility. They are having the flexibility. It means to say that the enzyme will not be having a specific shape, but when the substrate is getting fixed, when the substrate is coming in contact with the enzyme, when the substrate is coming in contact at enzyme, what will happen? It will convert its shape in such a manner that the enzyme will now start activating and will convert the substrate into product. Okay, so that is about the induced fit hypothesis. What it says? It says that key, the enzyme is flexible. It is not in manner. It's not having a particular shape. It is not basically like that, but lock and key. It will be flexible, and whenever an enzyme is basically coming in contact with substrate, it will change its shape according to substrate, and then it will convert the substrate into product. Okay, now active site is induced to assume a complementary shape in mud. It can be represented as a glove. Suppose if there is a glove within which we put a hand, so it will acquire the shape of that, right? So induced fit theory says that this is my active site, this is not having a specific shape, and this is my substrate. So when this substrate is getting in contact with this active site, what will happen? It will induce this enzyme to acquire a shape of that substrate. It will induce this enzyme to acquire the shape of substrate. Okay, and this is called as induced fit model. Both the models are basically accepted up to an extent, they are not accepted as well. Now the next is the inhibition of enzyme action. How this enzyme action can be inhibited. So mainly there are two types of inhibition can be done, that is competitive inhibition and the non-competitive inhibition. So let us start with the competitive inhibition. So whenever the binding of the chemicals shuts off, when the binding of chemical does not occur, like suppose the binding of chemical is occurring and still it is not changing in the substrate, it is not changing the product, then it is called as, that is inhibiting its activity, right? So inhibitors can be competitive or can be non-competitive. Competitive inhibitors are those inhibitors where the inhibitor molecule is similar to the substrate molecule, similar to the substrate molecule. So whenever the substrate molecule and inhibitor molecule are same, the active site will not be able to recognize it properly. The active site will not be able to recognize it properly, and the inhibitor molecule will acquire its position at this active site. It will bind at the active site. It will bind with active site, and due to which the active site will be basically now will not be able to carry out its function. Okay, and hence that enzyme will be inactive now. So it will basically decreasing the rate of reaction. It is decreasing the rate of reaction because the instead of the original substrate, some other molecule which is inhibitor will be attached to the active site, and due to which the enzyme will not be functional. Okay. So example, the malonate is a inhibitor similar to the succinate, and hence instead of succinate, the malonate may bind to the succinate arginase and can basically inhibit the activity. Okay. So in the complete inhibition, we can see closely resembles the substrate in molecular structure. Inhibitor competes for the substrate with substrate binding site of enzyme. As a result, the enzyme action declines. The inhibition of succinate dehydrogenase by malonate, which closely resembles the succinate in the structure, right? Such competitive inhibitors are often used in control of bacterial program. This is something this may be asked. So how it be used is sulfa drugs is a type of drug which is a type of competitive inhibitor for an enzyme which is basically synthesizing the folic acid synthesis. So the sulfa drug, what will it do? It will basically take the place of this folic acid synthesis precursor. So it's basically a type of molecule which is similar to the para amino benzoic acid, PABA. So what will happen? Normal cases, the PABA will be responsible for synthesis of folic acids. Okay, in the presence of an enzyme. But this sulfa drug is similar to the PABA, and it will acquire the position of the active site on the enzyme, and instead of PABA, this sulfa drugs will be getting binded with this particular enzyme, and hence this enzyme will not be able to synthesize folic acid, and in turn the bacteria will not be synthesized. Okay, so this is something how it works. Let us see over here, competitive inhibitor. So this is the enzyme, this is my substrate, and this is another molecule which is functioning as an inhibitor. It is not an original substrate, so both are basically having same type of shape partially. So instead of this substrate, what is happening? The other molecule, that is the inhibitor, has got attached. Now this inhibitor will not be converted into product. And hence this enzyme function is basically decreased down. Its rate of reaction has decreased down. So we can say the competitive inhibition decreases the rate of reaction. Competitive inhibition decreases the rate of reaction, and hence increases the Km. Okay. So that was about the competitive inhibition. Other one is the non-competitive inhibition. Non-competitive inhibition example is cyanide. Okay, so what happens? The cyanide is basically a type of poison which acts on the cytochrome C. Cytochrome C is a type of enzyme which plays a very important role in the respiration. So it's a type of respiratory enzyme where the respiration electron transport takes place. Okay, so what happens? The cyanide will be basically attacking. It will be attaching to the enzyme at any other site other than the binding site. So whenever there is a binding site. So suppose this is my active site. So this cyanide will be acting over here, and this will active over here. It will change the conformation of this in the enzyme in such a manner that no enzyme can bind over here now. So the inhibitor has no structure similarity with the substrate. Make it sure the inhibitor will be not having any similarity with the substrate structure, and it binds with the substrate binding site, but at some other site of the enzyme. Substrate binding take place, but no products are formed. Substrate may bind over here, but the products will not be formed. So again, the rate of reaction may be decreased. Okay. So allostatic modulation or feedback inhibition. So we have seen the competitive inhibition and the non-competitive inhibition. We will see it again once more. Allostatic modulation of feedback or feedback inhibition. Now we know that everything in body is basically taken care by the enzymes. And everything has to be taken, produced or synthesized in a proper manner. If anything is synthesized in a more amount, then it has to be blocked. The synthesis has to be blocked in a particular regulated fashion. If anything has to be synthesized, like suppose there is a scarcity of a particular amino acid, like say tryptophan. So this tryptophan has to be synthesized so that the enzymes which are required to form the synthesis has to be activated. But at the same time, suppose a particular product, that is ATP, is being formed at very high rate. So this ATP has to be blocked. Okay. So the synthesis of ATP has to be blocked. How it can block? By blocking the enzymes required for it. By blocking the enzymes. So the enzymes also provides a specific regulatory mechanism. The enzymes also provide a specific regulatory mechanism for carrying out the different metabolic reactions inside the cell. How it is happening? It will be basically taking place with the help of the allostric modulation. So let us see, the binding increases or decreases with the enzyme action. Such enzymes are called as allostric enzymes. Enzymes which are functioning as an allostric modulator, which are showing this allostric mechanism, will be called as allostric enzymes. Example, hexokinase, which changes glucose to glucose 6 phosphate. Now, what's the function of hexokinase? Converts the glucose to glucose 6 phosphate in glycolysis. So, whenever the decline in enzyme activity by allostric effect of product is called as feedback, like suppose the glucose 6 phosphate is present in high amount, so it has to be blocked. So, how it will be blocked? The glucose 6 phosphate will be binding to the hexokinase. Glucose 6 phosphate will be binding to hexokinase in such a way that hexokinase activity will be decreased, and hence it is called as allostric inhibition. So here we can see the activity of the allostric effect of the product is called effect back inhibition of hexokinase by glucose 6 phosphate. Okay, so whenever the glucose 6 phosphate is high amount, what will happen? This glucose 6 phosphate, which is the product, will bind to the hexokinase in such a way that it will inhibit this activity. And next is enzyme phosphofructokinase is activated by ADP and inhibited by ATP. So whenever there is a high amount of ATP, it will bind to the PFK, that is phosphofructokinase. It's an enzyme which is present in the glycolysis. So it will again inhibit the enzyme of PFK, and it will inhibit the glycolysis. Okay. So here we can see an example. So here is the hexokinase is an enzyme. Hexokinase enzyme which is responsible for converting glucose into glucose 6 phosphate. So what is happening? Glucose is getting converted to glucose 6 phosphate. Okay. By using the ATP and converting this ATP into ADP. Now this is the enzyme. Which enzyme is this? Hexokinase is converting the glucose into glucose 6 phosphate. Hexokinase is an enzyme which converts glucose into glucose 6 phosphate. So whenever the glucose 6 phosphate is high in amount, what will happen? It will bind to the hexokinase. It will bind to hexokinase at any other site apart from this active site, that is called allostric site. So when it binds to the hexokinase, what will happen? The hexokinase will now become non-functional. And in the absence of hexokinase, or we can say when the hexokinase is non-functional, this glucose is no more converted into glucose 6 phosphate. Glucose is no more able to convert into glucose 6 phosphate. And hence we can say the glucose is now not getting converted to glucose 6 phosphate. It means this pathway is blocked. How is it blocked? Is it blocked because this enzyme is blocked? Why this enzyme is blocked? Because this glucose 6 phosphate is bound to it. Why it is bound to it? Because it is present in higher number. So we can say everything is interconnected. So it is regulated. So whenever the pathway has to be switched off, this will be functioning as switching off and on mechanism. So glucose 6 phosphate attaches it, and it will be getting switched off. When it will this glucose 6 phosphate again release it out, it will getting switch on. Okay, similarly, if ADP is basically binding to it, it will switch on, switch off. If ATP is binding to it, it will switch off, switch on. Okay, so this is something which has to be clear. So feedback mechanism is basically regulated by the enzyme and binding of the product with the enzymes. Okay, now let us see the competitive inhibition again. How this competitive inhibition works. So this type of inhibition occurs when the inhibitor binds, I have just told you, reversibly to the same site. So it will be competing for the active site. Okay, competitive to the active site. Okay, so effect on Vmax. So what is the effect of Vmax? So if the effect of competitive inhibitor is reversed by increasing the substrate concentration. So if I increase the substrate concentration, what happens? The competitive inhibitor will not be basically inhibiting more, right? So it will be reversed. So at a sufficiently high substrate concentration, the reaction velocity reaches the Vmax observed in the absence of inhibitor. So when the concentration of substrate is increased, that the Vmax will not be having so change. It will be the same. Effect of Km, the competitive inhibitor increases the apparent Km for a given substrate, means that the presence of competitive inhibitor, more substrate needed to achieve half Vmax. So it decreases the Vmax, you can say, right? So let us see, what does it do? So in the presence of, with the competitive inhibitor and without the competitive inhibitor. So when the inhibitor is not there. So inhibitor is not there, the Vmax is same. Vmax by 2. So Km Michel increased. So Km is basically increased here with competitor. With increased competitor, what happens? This Km has shifted over here. Right? So Km is shifted. Okay, so Michel is constant, that Km is increased in the presence of competition, right? But Vmax will be remaining same. Vmax will be remaining same in competitive inhibitor. So let us see again the non-competitive inhibitor, how it works. So this enzyme substrate, this enzyme substrate complex, but along apart, this is the active site. But sometime it may happen that this inhibitor is getting is coming contact with this site, that is allostric site. It will bind to it and it is now inactive. This enzyme substrate inhibitor complex, this enzyme substrate inhibitor complex will now become inactive in nature. Okay, this is the how the competitive inhibitor, non-competitive inhibitors will be working. So that was about this. Next one is the non-competitive inhibition. We have seen characteristic effect on Vmax. This inhibitor and substrate bind at different site, as we have seen that both will be binding at different site. The non-competitive inhibitor can bind either free enzyme or ES complex, thereby preventing the reaction from occurring. So it can bind either to the free, it can bind to the free like here, or it can bind to the complex. So it can prevent the reaction because it will be making it inactive. Effect on Vmax, the Vmax cannot be overcome by increasing the concentration. So we cannot overcome the Vmax by increasing concentration because the non-competitive inhibitor decreases the Vmax. Or we can say the Vmax is decreased. In competitive inhibitor, what was there? The Vmax was same. Km was increased. Yahan pe, over here, the Vmax will remain same. So Vmax will decrease. Okay. And effect on Km, it will not interfere with the binding of the substrate to enzyme. Thus, enzyme shows the same Km. The Km will be remaining same. Okay. So in the case of non-competitive inhibitor, we can say the Km will remain same. The Km will remain same in both the cases, right? But Vmax will decrease. The Vmax will be decreasing. Vmax is here. In the case of non-competitive inhibitor, and in the case of without inhibitor, it is higher. And in the case of here, it will be decreased. But Vmax is, we can say Vmax is changed. But the Km is same. Km will be the same. Okay. So you have to understand in the case of non-competitive and competitive, both will be the difference. In the case of competitive inhibitor, Vmax will remain same and Km will be increased. While in the case of non-competitive inhibitor, Vmax will decrease and Km will remain same. We have already seen enzyme inhibition, so irreversible and reversible. Okay, so irreversible inhibition cannot be overcome and it destroys the enzymes. Okay, non-competitive inhibitor example cyanide. It will destroy the enzymes totally. It will destroy the enzymes totally. Reversible inhibition can be non-competitive or competitive. It can be non-competitive and competitive. And non-competitive can be chemical, like any of the chemical can get in and can be product. Whatever the, like we have seen glucose, this phosphate was a product of the glucose hexokinase, right? So here it can be product and can non-competitively bind to it and it can reversible. Competitively, like substrate analog, like the malonate to succinate and all that. So we have already done with this. Okay, that was about the enzymes. So the next topic, this is what we have done.